Hi everyone, welcome to the day 5 of Mini Astro Works of Release 2020. So today we have Ish Mohan Gupta with us. He has actually recently completed his Masters in Physics and B.Tech in Chemical Engineering at BITS Pilani KK Birla Goa campus. And he completed his Master's thesis at Penn State, working on a lot of interesting topics. One was on testing general relativity with gravitation wave observations, basically looking at the multipolar structure of gravitation waves and also using the no-hair theorem of black holes, where black holes are only described by spin and their mass, and even charge, but astrophysically charge is very less. So he's going to talk about this more later. And apart from this, he has also worked at TFR Mumbai, wherein he was working on the cosmological aspects of asymmetric metric tensor with torsion. So usually when you deal with general theory of relativity and you look at a certain metric, which he's going to introduce in his talk today too, we usually keep torsion zero. But he included the torsion in his metric and looked at its implications for the Einstein field equations and the resultant equations and dynamics. And he has also worked at IIT Kharagpur a little bit on computational astrophysics, wherein he actually looked at the solar cycles or the sunspot cycle that actually form on the sun. And he actually tried simulating them and looked at their life cycle. And while being at BITS Pilani KK Birla Goa campus, he has also worked on some mathematical aspects of general theory of relativity, wherein he worked on perturbations in cosmology, and some aspects of topology and differential geometry, which are really crucial for understanding the rigorous mathematics of general theory of relativity. And apart from this, he has also worked as a summer research fellow at IIT Madras, wherein he looked at the quantum to classical transition. So usually whenever people talk about classical and quantum, you don't really see a transition, right? As to when does exactly do quantum mechanics change to classical mechanics, or how does classical mechanics emerge out of quantum mechanics. So to understand this process, one needs to understand something called decoherence, so quantum decoherence, which can actually explain this transition from quantum mechanics and say how classical mechanics that you see usually around yourself can emerge out of quantum mechanical principles. So he has also worked on that. And he's also a very good boxer. So I guess with that, I leave the floor to Ish.
Thanks, Arinda. I hope I'm audible, and I'll just share my screen. And I'll start the presentation mode so people can tell me if everything is good. So yeah, here we are. Just start the pointer as well. Everything is working. Nice. Okay, yeah. Thanks, Arinda, for the introduction. Arinda is a very good friend of mine, which is the reason why I get such a big introduction. So thank you for that. And thank you for mentioning that I'm a boxer, because yeah, I am. Okay, great. So today we'll be talking about gravitational waves. I'll be introducing gravitational waves to you, but I have been told that the audience is a mix of people who might be specialists, but might be people who haven't really dwelled into gravitational waves. They have sort of heard about it enough, and they might not have the same background as, say, others, where some people might know general relativity, some might not. So I'm going to keep the introductory part to be very basic, where I just talk about gravitational waves in a very layman language. But when I do talk about my research, which is eventually going to be the case, I will go ahead and get a bit more technical. So I hope that is okay. Also, I cannot see the chat, so if there's anything, hopefully Surinder can just tell it to me.
Ish. So the way I think we'll go about is, if there's a pressing question, I'll try to bring it up. Okay. And else we could just take a 5 minutes break in between, and you can take up the questions in the chat.
Okay, I'll do that. So right after I've told you guys everything about gravitational waves, and before I start telling you about my research, I'll stop a bit and we'll discuss everything you guys want to know about gravitational waves, and then I can sort of go ahead and talk about my research. Okay?
Yes. So guys, as you listen, you can always post your questions to the chat.
Okay, sounds good. Okay, so again, even though Surendra has introduced me, very briefly, my name is Ish Mohan Gupta, or in short, Ish Gupta, and I am currently a graduate student at Penn State, and I'm also a member of the LIGO Scientific Collaboration, which basically means that I get to work with LIGO data before people who are not members, so yay. But yeah, so that, okay. Very quickly, we'll move on to just talking about science, because that's what we're here for. Okay. General relativity. Now, I would like to introduce general relativity in a sort of layman term, but I would want you to get the intuitive idea behind the theory. Okay. So one thing you have to realize about relativity is that it is really an update to Newton's notion of gravity. Okay. Because Newton always thought of gravity as being a force, you know, that thing that you write with a vector on top, vector symbol on top, or an arrow on top. Yeah, he thought that is what gravity was. And well, not just him, before Einstein, I guess everyone thought that gravity was a force. But Einstein thought that this notion of gravity that Newton sort of proposed was a bit problematic, okay? And what was the problem with this notion? Well, the problem was this. Say you have the sun, okay? All right, anybody, but let's take the sun, and there's nothing else in the entire solar system but just the sun. And then you place just one particle, just one, somewhere near the sun, and instantly that particle feels the attractive force of the sun, and the sun feels the attractive force of the particle. Instantly is the term which is important here. So this is action at a distance, basically meaning that there's no perceivable contact between the particle and the sun, and still instantly there is an effect of the particle on the sun and an effect of the sun on the particle, no matter how far away the particle is from the sun, which was troubling, right? Because how can anything travel instantly? And so Einstein said, okay, what, you know, wait a minute. I don't believe in this action at a distance crap. This should not happen. So what he instead proposed was a notion of space-time fabric. And you see fabric has been put in single quotes because this is a very layman term. In technical language, you'd say that space-time is actually a four-dimensional Hausdorff manifold, but we won't get into it because each of those terms will take ages to sort of explain. So I'll just call it a fabric. But a very intuitive idea of understanding what it is to just really imagine your bed sheet. And, you know, think about suspending your bed sheet in midair and think about placing a heavy mass on top of it. When you do place any kind of mass on top of it, the bed sheet sort of bends, right? It bends. So the mass adds some curvature to the otherwise flat bed sheet. And that is essentially what Einstein tries to tell you with his equations. What he says is that anytime you have a massive object, it is going to introduce some curvature in the space-time fabric. And that curvature is responsible for gravity. So gravity is not a force. It is an effect of the curvature. Now, how is this curvature responsible for gravity? Well, here it is. So you see this picture here, right? So now this is my sun, say, and it is, as it is massive, it is producing a curvature in the space-time fabric around it. Now here, say, is the Earth. Now, even Earth is massive. So you can see even Earth is producing a bit of curvature, right? But not as massive as the sun. So the curvature is not that much. Now think about this. Don't think that the Earth is rotating. Just think that you just placed the Earth, just placed it near the sun. What will happen? Well, of course, the Earth will just fall towards the sun, right? Just intuitively think about it. You place a massive object on the bed sheet. You place a small object near, and you just leave it there. And of course it will just fall down. Or the way to see it is that it gets attracted towards this massive object. And that attraction is what Einstein took and sort of said was gravity. And that is how the general theory of relativity or general relativity was made. That is the basic principle behind it. That gravity is not really a force. It is an effect of the curvature of space-time. Why I have sort of put this equation here is, well, because it's the Einstein equation. And for me, it is the most beautiful equation I've ever seen. but also because this equation sort of tells you what he really meant. Because the left-hand side of this equation is purely geometric. These are tensors, and you don't have to know what tensors are or anything. Just think of them as quantities. And these quantities are purely geometric, meaning that these quantities tell you how space-time is. You know, how is it curved, where it is curved. All this is described by the metric or a quantity called metric. And these quantities are just functions of that metric. So the left-hand side is nothing but telling you how is the space-time bent. And the right-hand side tells you about the mass distribution. The T mu nu you see here is just a stress energy tensor. So it really just tells you about the mass distribution. How is mass distributed in space-time? And the most beautiful thing of them all is this equal to sign. Why? Because it absolutely definitely relates geometry with mass distribution. It tells you exactly how space-time is going to be curved because of the mass that you put on, and which is what the Einstein equation says, and which is why it's good. You know, it gives you definite answers. Well, it is very difficult to solve technically, to get absolute solutions. It's very difficult. But if you are able to get one, well, it's going to tell you exactly how things work, exactly how gravity will work in a given system, which is why it's amazing. Okay. And what also sort of separates general relativity from Newtonian theory, even though it's an update, but it's a very sort of a, you know, leaps and bounds kind of an update. It's not an Apple like iOS 10.1 to 10.2. No. So it's not that. But why it is also important is because it introduces new notions like notion of gravitational time dilation. And if you have heard of time dilation in special relativity, it is more or less a more generalized notion of time dilation, where you say that time moves at different rates in different inertial frames, if that is in special relativity. So yeah. It also points towards the existence of black holes, which is important because that is what we're going to talk about. And it introduces the notion of gravitational waves, which again is what we're going to talk about. So it's a nice theory. It's a nice update. It's worth mentioning nevertheless. Now let's see what gravitational waves are. Again, a very, not a very basic, but a sort of a basic idea about gravitational waves. Well, I told you, right, that Einstein had a problem with action at a distance. So how did his theory really solve anything for that matter? Well, here's how. So what he said is that, okay, you've placed a sun sort of an object or a massive object in the middle of the your bed sheet. Now, when you place it in the middle of the bed sheet, does the bed sheet instantly get curved? It doesn't, right? Because when you place it in the middle of the bed sheet, first the effect is felt by the point of contact on the bed sheet with the object, right? That is the first place which feels the effect of the body. And then the areas around it sort of get curved. Then the areas around it sort of get a bit more curved, and so on, till the curvature sort of propagates to the outside layers of the bed sheet. And after a finite amount of time, you'll see that the entire bed sheet got curved. So this disturbance that you introduced on the fabric of space-time, which was initially flat, right? Because your bed sheet was initially flat, you introduced a disturbance, and you see that this disturbance takes a finite time to propagate from the point to all the point outwards. And this disturbance, or how I have termed it here as perturbations, which propagate outwards due to disturbance in the space-time fabric, are what are called gravitational waves. So when it comes to space-time and the theory of general relativity, any perturbations in the space-time fabric propagate outwards in a wave-like nature, and they propagate outwards at the speed of light. If you're finding the bedsheet analogy difficult, think about a pond and you dropping a pebble in the pond. When you do drop a pebble in the pond, you actually see ripples sort of going outwards, and you see them going outwards in a wave-like nature. This is essentially what it is, right? And when it happens in the space-time fabric, it is called gravitational waves. Now, a bit more technical term would be to say that gravitational waves are essentially proportional to the second time derivative of the mass quadrupole moment. Now, I'll explain each of these terms, but why is this important to understand? Because you'll say, okay, does any kind of perturbation to space-time introduce gravitational waves? Well, no. What kind of perturbation? Well, here it is. Here it is, which tells you what has to happen to introduce gravitational waves. Now let's go to each term, okay? So let's go to the mass quadrupole moment first, okay? And to understand quadrupole moment, let's start two steps back. Let's start at a monopole. So what is a mass monopole or a gravitational monopole? Well, it is just a measure of the mass of the object, nothing more than that, just the measure of the mass. Okay, then what is a gravitational dipole? Well, a gravitational dipole is nothing but a measure of how mass is distributed away from the center in some direction. So say you have a ring of particles, okay? And at any point inside the ring, any point, not the center, at any point inside the ring, you just pinpoint a point and you say, okay, now I want to know how the mass is distributed around this point. And that will give you the dipole moment around that point. Now, when I say how mass is distributed about a point, if you get the idea of center of mass in some sense, because that is how center of mass is calculated, you're absolutely right. There is a relationship here. And the relationship is that the dipole moment around the center of mass is actually zero, because that's the point of the center of mass, right? So yeah, because everything is, you know, equally distributed or fairly distributed around the center of mass. So it's like that. And that gives you an idea of the gravitational dipole, so to say. Now we go to quadrupole. Now quadrupole is a measure of how stretched out the mass is along some axis. Now what does stretched out mean? Okay, think about a sphere, okay? You have an axis passing through the center of the sphere, and the sphere may be rotating, maybe not, actually it doesn't matter, okay? Now, no matter how you place the axis around the center of the sphere, you will always see that mass is distributed or stretched out equally around that sphere, around that axis, sorry. So the quadrupole moment is more or less zero. It's not much happening. But what if you had a rod and you had an axis passing through just the tip of the rod? Just the tip of the rod. Well, then it is definitely, mass is definitely stretched out in a particular direction along that axis or about that axis. And that is exactly what we wanted. So a rod where the axis is passing through the tip of the rod has a non-zero quadrupole moment. But what if this rod was simply rotating, just simply at a constant angular velocity? Would that also produce gravitational waves? Well, at that point, we start to look at this term, the second time derivative. So we don't just need a non-zero mass quadrupole moment. We also need the second time derivative of the mass quadrupole moment to be non-zero for there to be gravitational waves. If the second time derivative of the mass quadrupole moment is non-zero, you will have gravitational waves. The mass of the object doesn't matter. You will have gravitational waves. Where the mass of the object comes into play is how strong those gravitational waves are, you know? If you can even detect them or not, which is why we actually look at black holes or neutron stars for gravitational waves, because they are massive. So a very brief introduction into gravitational waves. Moving on to effects of passing of gravitational waves, because this is important. This is what helps us realize how gravitational waves can actually be detected. And I hope the GIFs are working so you can actually see plus polarization and cross polarization. But anyways, we'll get to that. So yeah, now the effects of passing of gravitational waves. So what gravitational waves are really are ripples in the fabric of space and time. So it makes sense to think that when gravitational waves pass, they are not doing anything but stretching and contracting space and time. That's it. That's all they are doing. That's what a wave does, right? When it passes through a fabric, stretches and contracts. That is all it does. And that is what gravitational waves do to the space-time fabric. Now, if I bring you back to the electromagnetic theory, you remember that thinking about polarizations. Well, gravitational waves also have two polarizations, the plus polarization and the cross polarization. Now, what is the difference? Well, the difference is how they stretch and contract things. So here, I'm giving you an example of a ring of masses. And I'm showing you that if a plus polarization gravitational wave passes through a ring of masses, how is it going to contract and stretch? And you see exactly how, right? You see a sort of a plus shape forming, which is why it is called plus polarization. Similarly, if you only had the cross polarization in the gravitational wave, this is how it stretches and contracts. And you can see it is a cross-like shape, hence the cross polarization. Gravitational wave waveform, or rather the function that represents the gravitational waves, has both plus and cross polarizations, okay? But it is easy to see them individually so that you can understand why one is called plus and the other is called cross. Now, this gives you an idea. Okay, so what it really does is that it stretches and contracts space and time. So what can I really do to detect it? Well, there are many things you can do to detect it. In principle, you can just play a ring, place a ring of masses like this, and you can expect to see contractions, and you can expect to see stretching, and you'll be like, okay, if there is stretching and contraction that I'm seeing, then well, gravitational wave is passing. But that is not true, because the strength of the gravitational wave is not so much. And for that, I'll give you an example. So the event 150914, and you know what, here I'll just take a detour and tell you exactly what 150914 means, or tell you exactly how LIGO names its events. So the first two letters, the first two numbers, is the year. So this event was in 2015, hence 15. The second two numbers is the month, 09, so September, 14, the last two events are the date. So 14th September 2015 is when this event was recorded. Hence it is called 150914. Okay, so this was a 30 solar mass event, meaning that the total mass of the two bodies was 30 times the mass of the sun. And even then, when the gravitational waves from this event passed through the Earth, the change in length of a 4 kilometer long LIGO arm was by 1/1000th of the width of a proton. That small, 1/1000th of a width of a proton. So that is the amount of change, that is the amount of stretching and contraction it really produces. So you can't really think about placing a ring in front of you, just taking the necklace off from your neck and placing it and thinking that, you know what, it'll work. No, it won't. You won't see anything. What you do need, or what people usually do, is laser interferometry. What does that mean? So here, I'm giving you an easy example of a Michelson interferometer, which you might have done in the lab, or if you haven't, it's okay. But if you know about interference, this is easy to understand. What really happens is that when there is interference, you get a certain number of fringes, right? A certain number of fringes or interference fringes, and you get them when you sort of look through a lens, and it's okay. Now, what if the length of one arm changes? If the length of one arm changes suddenly, just for an instant, there will be a fringe shift, right? Because there will be a phase difference in the light that is traveling to one mirror versus the light that is traveling to another mirror. So there will be a difference. And this fringe shift will help you realize that there was a change in the length of the arm. Not just that, if you actually are able to measure the fringe shift, you can exactly tell how much was the change in the arm. And this is the sort of principle that they use in the LIGO interferometers, where they actually allow, and now these are long arms, these are not like the apparatus you have in a lab, as I said, 4 kilometer arms. So they allow for light to keep traveling between mirrors in these long arms. And when a gravitational wave passes through the Earth, there's a change in the length of the distance traveled by light between these arms. And that change helps you realize what the waveform of the gravitational wave really is, or what the function of the gravitational wave really is. And that is how these gravitational waves are really detected. Okay, so again, a very basic example of it, not very technical. Okay, moving on. Sources of gravitational waves. Now, this is important because this is going to help us eventually, like at many places. So the first source, which is not so important, is that of continuous gravitational waves. Okay, so now, as I told you, if you have the double time derivative, the second time derivative, sorry, of the mass quadrupole moment as non-zero, gravitational waves will be produced. Now think of a neutron star that has some aberration on its surface, okay? Because of which it is not completely spherical. It is just a bit weird, so to say, okay? So then if that neutron star is rotating with that aberration on its surface, you will have a non-zero mass quadrupole moment. And not just that, if it's actually rotating with it, you will have the double time derivative of the mass quadrupole moment also being non-zero. So you'll continuously keep getting gravitational waves out of it, which is what is called continuous gravitational waves. Now, these are generally very, very weak. So these, I don't think they are currently detectable, to be honest. I mean, they exist in the background, which will sort of come to when we come to the third point. But yeah, they're there, but not so relevant as of now, given the sensitivity of our detectors. So let me skip the second point and come to third. I'll finish with the second, okay? So for the second point, we talk about the stochastic gravitational waves or stochastic gravitational background, by which we mean that, as I mentioned, there are sources that are continuously producing gravitational waves. Okay, but most of these are not detectable. This just somehow rests in the background. There might be two or three of them overlapping. There might be millions of them overlapping for that matter. But there might be two or three of them overlapping, and you don't really have means as of now to sort of differentiate them, to actually measure them or do anything with them. So they form a very pleasant and calm background at the back, which is called a stochastic gravitational wave background. And it is just there. There's not much you can do about it. As of now, people are actually trying. There is research going on to get properties out of it. And some people have been somewhat successful, but not really. So yeah, but there are ways you can go about it. We might talk about it later if you want, but yeah. Okay. Coming back to the second thing, which is important for us. It is the compact binary gravitational waves. So gravitational waves that are produced by compact binary mergers. Now, what do I mean by compact binary mergers? So, well, black hole mergers, which we call BBH or binary black hole mergers, neutron star black hole mergers, which we call NSBH or just neutron star black hole mergers, or the NSNS, which is the neutron star mergers, which are called BNS or binary neutron star mergers. Okay, so we look at these three. And these three are important for us because these three are what we have been detecting with LIGO for so long, okay? Now, for these three, this diagram here sort of becomes important for these three mergers because any kind of gravitational wave that we obtain has three parts to it. One is the inspiral part, then we have the merger part, and then we have the ring down part. So let's start with the inspiral part. What is the inspiral part? So think about a binary. And that binary is doing nothing but sort of just rotating around their fixed center of mass. That's all it is doing, right? And while it is rotating in that manner, it is sort of kind of just coming closer together. Why? Because it's losing energy, right? If it's rotating and the gravitational waves are sort of propagating outside, gravitational waves carry energy. So where is that energy going to come from? It is going to come from the energy of the binary system itself. So if energy is leaving the system will slowly start coming closer together. That is the inspiral part, meaning how the two components of the binary sort of inspiral towards each other, just coming closer and closer and closer till they reach here and they merge, which is the merger part. And once they have merged, and formed another black hole, or for in case of neutron stars, again, another black hole. So then you sort of think, what happens then? Well, the black hole has a very specific way of stabilizing into a stable one, into a stable black hole after merger. And that stabilization process is called ring down. Okay. There is a lot of theory behind it, which includes black hole perturbation theory, where you actually get quasi-normal modes and things like that. But not much to think about it, to be honest, in the sense that, I mean, there is a lot to think about, but not for what we are doing. Because everything I'm going to talk about today really just focuses on the in-spiral part of things, not on the merger or the ring down part. Now, one important thing to note is, we have waveforms from general relativity that tell us how the in-spiral part works, okay? We have theory from general relativity, again, as I mentioned, black hole perturbation theory, that tells us how the ring down part works. You know, we have exact solutions, but we really don't know about the merger part, meaning that we need supercomputers, we need NR simulations to tell us how this part here, the merger part, is going to go about. And that is why usually the waveforms that we use, like the waveform I'm going to mention later, the IMR phenom waveform, it really uses numerical simulations for the merger part, because there's not much you can do about it. There has been work, definitely. But yeah, till now, nothing certain. But the in-spiral and ring down part, we more or less know things about it, so which is good. Okay, now moving on. Now this slide is again sort of important because it tells you both our limitations and why we have to look forward to the coming years. Now what this tells us is about the sensitivity of our interferometers. Basically saying that, okay, we have terrestrial interferometers right now. Terrestrial interferometers meaning that we have interferometers, LIGO interferometers on Earth. That is why terrestrial. And their sensitivity is enough to only look at rotating neutron stars or maybe some compact binaries, like in terms of BBHs or binary black hole mergers, but not all of them. So we can't really comment anything about supermassive black hole mergers because their frequencies are much farther away from what the sensitivity of our current detectors, just the terrestrial ones, will allow. It's much farther away from. So when I say that we can look at binary black hole mergers, we can look at binary black hole mergers where the masses, the total mass ranges from somewhere around 10 to 15 solar masses, and it can go to about, a couple hundreds maximum. So yeah, that is the sort of range that we have as of now. Okay, it might actually increase in the future, but yeah, that is what we have. What we can look forward to is this part. The space interferometers, okay? Why? Because in space, the noise sensitivity has a much better curve when you compare it to the Earth, okay? There is not all that terrestrial noise, seismic noises, none of that. I mean, there is still noise in space interferometers, but it is not as much as compared to the terrestrial interferometers, which is why you are able to cover a much larger area, where you're able to cover even some supermassive black hole, binary supermassive black holes. And not just, you know, your neutron stars and things like that. So that is important, right? Because the more you get to know about these things, the more you learn. Hence, I said that we actually should look forward to the coming years because we'll be able to look at objects like supermassive black holes, which is amazing. And when I say the coming years, it's not really 50 years down the lane. No, no, just 10 would do probably, but yeah. Okay. The next thing I wanted to sort of show you is this, okay? So now let's look at 150914, the first event that I told you about.
Maybe let's take a 5-minute break or something.
Okay, sure. Shall we do questions?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you mind sort of giving
me? Yeah, I'll read them to you. Yeah.
Okay, awesome, awesome.
So just before that, guys, please don't have parallel discussions on the chat. The speaker is here taking his own time, so he will definitely answer the questions. So the first question is from Manish. He's asking, so you were trying to give this analogy, right? Wherein Earth falls like a bedsheet and things falling to the center.
Yeah.
So he's asking then why Earth not fall into the sun according to relativity?
That's very good. So, I mean, this is again, something that you can try to do for yourself, which is, so as I said, I just dropped Earth on the bedsheet, right? And it fell. The point there is that I dropped it. The Earth actually is rotating around the sun, isn't it? Right? It is actually rotating around the sun. It is in a bound orbit around the sun. And that is important, okay? Which is the fact that, which also relativity also allows bound orbits. It's not like relativity doesn't allow bound orbits. So it also allows bound orbit. It's just that when I said that if you drop something, it falls towards the sun, it's because then there is no bound orbit really. You're just dropping something. The only sort of way that the thing can go is downwards, and it does. If you see in this picture, you see a sort of white-ish orbit around. And the Earth can very well stay in this orbit, right? Just like even though the force is acting towards the center, if you think about classical things, when the force is acting towards the center, the thing still moves in a circular motion. It doesn't just fall towards the center. It's a very similar analogy to the Earth in the case of gravitational waves, in the case of general relativity, sorry. It's a bound orbit. Just that why the Earth doesn't fall is because it is rotating. It is in a bound orbit. It won't really fall down. If, however, I just drop the Earth somehow, somewhere nearby, well, it will fall. There's no way for it to remain in a bound orbit. So that.
And next, I want to know, does an Earth and Sun system also produce gravitational waves?
Does the Earth and Sun system? Sure, anything for that matter will produce gravitational waves. It's just that, as I said, why we really look at massive black holes, and when I say massive, 30 times the mass of the Sun and things like that, is because, well, the mass is that high because of which gravitational waves can be produced. The mass of the Sun, well, it is still comparable to that of black holes because the ones that we are talking about still are mass black holes, but not of the Earth. The Earth is minute when you compare it to the Sun, let alone black holes. So because of which, even the gravitational waves that are produced are like, you cannot really detect them. There are gravitational waves. Of course there are, because the mass quadrupole moment is changing, but you cannot really detect them.
And the next question from Santanu is asking, does the space-time fabric follow Newton's third law? That is to perturbation due to gravity generate some kind of negative perturbations?
Negative perturbations, not really. So perturbations really just propagate. That's it. There is no sort of action and reaction sense to it. You know, it is just perturbations. That's it. No negative perturbations. So that is why you see, when I talk about analogies, this is a place where analogies sort of fail. When you start taking analogies too literally, which is because when you think about a fabric, you would sort of think about it in a classical manner and you'll be like, okay, if I do something, I'll feel something back, right? So it is not really like that. So that is where the analogy fails. It's just a perturbation and it propagates. So yeah.
And the next question from Nitesh and also some other people have asked, what makes the gravitational waves polarized?
What makes the gravitational wave polarized? Okay, well, so there are, so there's a mathematical way to answer it. I'll give you the mathematical way. Surendra, if you know a more intuitive way, then please feel free to say. But what happens is that when you're really solving equations for gravitational waves, you see that there are 2 degrees of freedom still left, which is basically you saying that there are 2 different ways, 2 independent ways available, which both satisfy the equation. Okay. So there is no reason for only one of them to exist. And you actually see that both of them do. And that is why you sort of have 2 degrees of freedom and 2 polarization of gravitational waves. But yeah, that is a more mathematical way of saying it. Surendra, do you know of a more intuitive way of telling it?
I'm trying to think too. Let's see, I'll try to answer it later.
Sure, sounds good. I'll think about it as well. Please, yeah, but go ahead.
So Ayushi is asking, could you please explain what is the meaning of double time derivative being non-zero to produce CW?
Okay, double time derivative being non-zero. Okay, I'll tell that. I'll just tell that once. Okay, so double time derivative being non-zero, you can sort of think of it in terms of acceleration, right? So if your position is x and you say that dx by dt is non-zero, dx by dt is just velocity. So all you're saying is that the single time derivative of position is non-zero or the velocity is non-zero. Now, if you have acceleration as well, you take a d2x by dt2, or the double time derivative of position, which is acceleration, and you say that is non-zero. So essentially now in this example, just change position to mass quadrupole moment and you have the exact same thing, right? So the double time derivative of the mass quadrupole moment being non-zero is just that. So think about a rod, put a sphere at the end of it, and just make it rotate about the other end, you know, in an accelerating manner. So you'll see that, okay, there's a non-zero mass quadrupole moment because, well, there's a sphere at the end of it, and plus it is rotating in an accelerating way. So even the double time derivative of the mass quadrupole moment is going to be non-zero, right? Because it is accelerating while it is rotating plus with a non-zero mass quadrupole moment. Hence the double time derivative or the second time derivative being non-zero. Yeah.
And then maybe this is a bit more technical questions. Siddharth is asking, doesn't a quadrupole mean presence of four masses? Like an electric quadrupole, how exactly is a mass quadrupole different?
Okay, so how exactly is a mass quadrupole? So, okay, I'll give you an example in terms of dipoles first. So hope you'll understand from there. So why, you know that electromagnetic waves are just produced by dipole, right? So why doesn't the same thing happen for a mass dipole? Well, the reason is that in an electric dipole, you have a positive and a negative charge, right? Because of which there, once you replace the positive charge with the negative charge, you sort of flip it, there is a dipole moment change. So there is some change happening there. But for a mass dipole, such a thing does not exist. You don't have a negative mass. You only have positive masses. So if you have two bodies of masses, sort of two masses kept away from each other, if you replace their positions, still nothing has happened, right? It's still the exact same configuration. You can do that with four masses as well. Still the exact same configuration. If you keep them at the sides of a square, M, just replace all of them, you still have the same thing. Won't happen with charge. If you have Q minus Q or something like that, you'll have something, right? So exactly that. But when you have, say, M, 2M, okay, on the four corners, then there will be a sort of a quadrupole moment, because then you see how what I said is how mass is stretched around an axis. So on three sides of it, you just have M. On the other side, you have 2M. So there is a directional component to it. And then you can think about it changing and things like that. So, yeah.
Okay, the next question, let's see. What kind of noise is present in space? Radiation pressure?
Yeah, very true. Very true. Radiation pressure, and you just have noise due to photons, which again, radiation pressure, sure, just coming from all the sides. So yeah, I mean, there is going to be noise in space. It is vacuum, but there is still radiation around, right? So that for sure. I don't really know all the kinds of noises. Just like for terrestrial, I mentioned, seismic noises and all that. So, and terrestrial noises like just a car passing by. But I don't really know all the kinds of noises, but radiation pressure for sure. Yeah. Anything you can think of that can sort of, you know, work there. So, yeah.
Next, Nitesh is asking, can there be more asymmetries other than geometrical or shape of the source which produces gravitational waves?
More asymmetries other than what? Shape of the source, you said, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, again, when you think about binaries, think about this system exactly that is present here. Isn't this an asymmetric system, right? Because the mass of one is much different from the mass of the other, which is what we're going to see later, that it is actually really helpful. But such an asymmetry also helps. So at the end of the day, as I said, it has to be an asymmetry that causes the second time derivative of your mass quadrupole moment to change. Any kind of asymmetry that you can produce so that the second time derivative of the mass quadrupole moment is non-zero will produce gravitational waves. That is just how it is. So, yeah.
Yeah. And Suman is asking, is LIGO equipped to detect the exact polarization state of a gravitational wave? If it is, how does it detect that exact polarization of the gravity?
So, exact polarization meaning if it is exactly H plus or exactly H cross, is that what it means? I'm not sure.
I think so. I think he wants to know if it can detect H plus H cross. Yeah.
If it can detect exactly H plus and exactly H cross. Well, let's see. I think it should be able to, because you have very particular forms of these H plus and H cross at the end of the day. So as I said, these are 2 degrees of freedom, but you have very particular forms for how H plus looks and how H cross looks. So you should be able to, Surinder, correct me if I'm wrong here, but isn't that the way?
Yeah, both happens in different planes, right? So yeah. One has to know that the gravitational wave is coming at the detector at an inclination or something and resolve it in the plane of the detector. And through that, they'll be able to detect partial H plus and partial H cross. But if you really want to detect H plus or H cross, the gravitational signal should actually arrive at the LIGO detector perpendicular to the plane of the LIGO.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, true. So yeah, that.
Okay. I think we'll take two more questions and then we'll move with the talk.
Got it. Okay.
So is the center of Milky Way, so Ayush is asking, is the center of Milky Way an eligible candidate for detecting continuous gravitational waves?
Center of Milky Way is supposed to be a supermassive black hole. I wouldn't say a black hole will never have any aberrations on its surface. That just won't happen. I mean, it is so a black hole is a purely spherically symmetrical solution of the gravitation wave equations. Okay, it is purely spherically symmetric. There are no aberrations. There is no notion of an aberration on the surface of a black hole. And for continuous gravitational waves, that was a requirement, right? Because again, you need the second time derivative of the mass quadrupole moment to be non-zero. So that, so center of the Milky Way, I don't think so.
So here's an interesting question from Nitesh. He wants to know, how are these binary black holes produced? I mean, if it's in a binary system, if one of the stars becomes a black hole, it will start eating its partner binary. Then how will two black holes form in a binary?
How will okay, I think Surinder, that is a question more to your expertise. So would you mind answering this?
Yeah, so it's like you have two regular binary stars which are revolving around each other. And occasionally, not like eventually, if both the stars have masses above 8 solar mass, so to form a black hole, usually to undergo a core collapse supernova and form a black hole or something, usually the masses of the stars that you start with, like your main sequence stars, it should be around some 15 to 20 solar mass. So once you start with such a binary, wherein the two regular stars, for example, are in main sequence and have 50 to 20 solar mass, and they're revolving around each other and losing energy, and they're coming close to each other, one of them might will stop having any nuclear fusion happening. So it'll undergo a core collapse supernova. So once it goes under a core collapse supernova, it forms a black hole. Okay. During this situation, during the formation of the black hole and this core collapse supernova, the system might actually get disrupted because of the huge kick that the star that went under core collapse supernova might get. If the kick is not so high, the binary will still remain in that binary orbit and they will still go under that evolution. And eventually after some time, the mass from the other star gets accreted onto the this black hole or something, it might grow. So a lot of complex dynamics. But then eventually even the other star will go under core collapse supernovae, and that will also form a black hole. Even in this case, the binary might actually get disrupted. So, but if the kick that the black hole gets after the formation is low, and then they'll remain in this binary orbit and they'll eventually coalesce. So not all binary stars, regular stars that you see out there will actually result in a binary black holes, because there are so many complex process happening. So one might actually get a huge kick and escape the binary and get disrupted. So out of 100, if you take 100 binaries, only 2 to 3 binaries out of those 100 regular star binaries actually form a binary black hole system. And there's a lot more complex dynamics going on. If you're interested, we can always discuss later.
Yeah. Thanks, Arinda. So shall we move on then?
Yeah.
Okay, sounds good. So I'll be a bit faster because I think I have like 6 more slides, so, and we don't have much time. So I'll just go a bit faster, okay? So, okay, let's see. So I wanted to show you this diagram because I wanted to tell you about different events and how the waveform sort of looked for each of them. So when I say waveform, you remember, I mean the function that describes the wave, right? So for 1509, 14, we sort of saw, right? In spiral, then merger, and then ring down. And we saw what this looked like. Now, the good one here is 1708, 17. The first binary neutron star merger that we got, at least the loudest one that we have, and the first one, I think, too. So yeah. And what you see here is that it has a long in spiral. Just a long, long in spiral. You know, just the in spiral region is way too long. And you can sort of think about why that is happening, you know, because if you have two very, very massive objects, like say 20 solar mass black holes, just sort of, you know, in spiral around each other, there is greater attraction between them because of the masses, and they are going to lose energy faster, and they are going to merge faster. Neutron stars have masses around one to two solar masses, sometimes even 2.2 and maybe 2.8 as well, seems like. But yeah, so around that, and those are very small, okay, compared to 20 solar mass black holes. So they take their good time to sort of in spiral around each other, lose energy slowly, which is why you can even see the amplitude of the wave being very small compared to say 1509, 14. And they move very slowly. They sort of inspire slowly, and they slowly and slowly they come towards a merger, and they finally merge. Well, they don't merge here, they merge later, but yeah, you get the point. So that happens. And neutron stars take their time. It's a huge signal. Neutron star, binary neutron star mergers, humongous signals. Compared to what you see for 1509, 14, it's less than a second worth of signal. So there you go. Okay. Now, at the bottom, I also wanted to show you these chirps, as we call them, which are actually obtained in the detectors. So as you see, the region here has a certain frequency which sort of shoots up, and then the merger happens. So in spiral, in spiral, in spiral, coming close, coming close, coming close, merges, and then nothing. And this is essentially what happened for 1509-14. So this is a picture right from the discovery paper of 1509-14, the first paper that LIGO gave out for this event for 1509-14. And this is an image from there. Similarly, I wanted to show you 1708-17 as well, which is here, and show you exactly what I meant when I said that it has a long in spiral. You see? A long in spiral to finally merge. And when it merges, of course, the frequency goes up. It has to during merger, but it has a long in spiral compared to a binary black hole merger, which 1509-14 was. So yeah, that's sort of the difference between the two. Okay, now here is the important thing. Gravitational waves, gravitational waves, gravitational waves. What can we actually measure using gravitational waves? Well, you can measure a lot of things about the compact binaries, but with varying amount of accuracies, okay? So there are two sets of parameters that we usually look at. The first set of parameters is called the intrinsic parameters, which means that it is intrinsic to the compact binary system that we're talking about, okay? These are the masses of the two components of the binary. So if it's a black hole or black hole neutron star, anything. And we usually don't talk about the individual masses. We talk about these two sort of quantities that appear when we are doing calculations for waveforms of gravitational waves, which are called chirp mass and mass ratio. Now, mass ratio is very easy to understand because it is just the mass of the heavier component divided by mass of the less heavier component, so to say, and or the lighter component. But I don't like to say lighter because let's not forget these are multiple times the solar mass, so none of it is any light, but yeah. And the first one, chirp mass, is again a function of the two masses. So yeah, you get these two. And you can easily, so if you have mass one and mass two, and you know the values of two functions of mass one and mass two, you can easily go to get mass one and mass two. But essentially, we always talk about chirp mass and mass ratios. Now, the second thing that we can get is spin and precession. Okay, so if the two components themselves are spinning, then we can get that. And if the plane in which they are spinning itself is precessing, then we can get that as well. So you get this information as well. And if you are thinking, okay, how do you get this information? Well, all this is encoded in the waveforms that we use to detect these gravitational waves, okay? Because we have a theory that is correct, at least to the best of our knowledge. We have general relativity, which can give us gravitational wave waveforms. All we have to do is we have to tell the theory that our component masses have this much mass, they have this much spin, and they can precess. So what should the waveform look like? And your theory produces it for you. So yeah. Now, if you have neutron stars as one or both of the components of the compact binary, you will also have tidal deformities, basically meaning that, you know, the neutron star itself deforms because of the presence of another compact object in the binary. So, and you can even measure this, not with a good accuracy, let me tell you, because of which I said that all these components, all these quantities can be measured with varying amounts of accuracies. Chirp mass and mass ratio, you can measure very accurately. Okay, tidal deformity, not so much. Can't. If you want to know why, Surendra is the better person to answer, because neutron stars, he knows best. So yeah, okay. Extrinsic parameters. For extrinsic parameters, we are usually looking at sky location. Okay, so we look at right extension, we look at declination, inclination angle, luminosity distance, polarization angle, phase, everything. Okay, and you can actually get all these, but again, with varying amount of accuracies. And that is a big, big point. Okay, don't think that you get one value for all these. We'll discuss this. You won't get one value. You always get distributions. And I'll talk about that. Okay, so this is all that you can measure. But how do you measure this? Okay, so the way you measure any of these things is called parameter estimation. Essentially, what you do is you have a waveform with you, okay, which you got by using general relativity. You match this waveform to the data that you have. Okay, it's called match filtering. This is a very sort of basic explanation of what match filtering is. But you match this waveform to the data that you have, and from this, you obtain distributions for the parameters, okay? We'll see what distributions actually also means, but yeah, you obtain distributions. Now, since the data has noise, you cannot really predict exact values of the parameters, right? The data has noise, there is disturbance. You cannot say this is exactly how the waveform looks, okay? But you can make good guesses, which is what we do, okay? So, which is why I say that instead of obtaining an exact value, you actually obtain distributions. And how do we do this? Well, the base of the techniques is to use Bayes or the Bayes theorem in probability theory. So we'll just look at it very fast. This is a bit technical, but I think you'll be able to follow me. And probably this is the most wordy slide I have, and it's because I want you guys to read it. I'll obviously talk over it, but later on also I want you to be able to read it and understand what I meant by it, okay? And also this, I did not want to do all this LaTeX typing, so I just copy-pasted it from my thesis, so which is why it might look a bit blurred, but that. Okay, so let's look at the Bayes theorem. Now, if you've seen Bayes theorem, you sort of understand what this is, but let me tell you about the terminology that we use when we're talking about gravitational wave data analysis, okay? So the first term here, or rather let's start with the definition of these things, okay? So what is E here? E is nothing but the parameter you're looking at. So say I want to see what chirp mass is. So chirp mass is going to be E. What is D here? D is nothing but the data that you got from the gravitational wave detection. What is H? H is our hypothesis. What do I mean by hypothesis? Well, you have a multitude of waveforms. Okay, you have the IMR phenom family of waveforms. You have the SEO-BNR family of waveforms. You have a multitude of waveforms. Which one do you really use for this particular event? So that is your hypothesis. You assume a particular waveform and you go ahead by calculating the probability distribution of obtaining a parameter value given the data and the waveform that you're using on the data, okay? Probability distribution of the parameter value given the data and the waveform you're using for that data. And by Bayes theorem, all this means is that first you have the probability of the parameter, of obtaining the parameter given just the waveform. So this is called a prior. Essentially, this is on us. We sort of give it a certain probability distribution saying that, okay, I expect the chirp mass to be between say 5.5 to 10.5 solar masses. And I expect it to be have a uniform probability in this range, meaning that I expect any value between 5.5 to 10.5 to be equally probable, to have an equal chance of being the actual value. Again, this is a guess. Priors are just educated guesses. And yes, your probability does depend on them, which is why you would want to make good educated guesses. Okay. Now, the second value is what we call the likelihood, which is that given the waveform I have, and say I choose a parameter value, what is the probability that I get the data that I'm getting? Okay. So if I put that parameter value in that waveform, what is the probability that I get the data that I'm getting? That is the likelihood. Finally, at last, at the end, we just have a normalization constant. At the end, all the probabilities, everything should go to one, need to normalize. Okay. You usually call this as the evidence, sort of can, yeah, go ahead, calculate it. You should get eventually everything done, should get one. Finally, the left-hand side, this is what you are calculating. Because you have the data, you have the waveform, what you don't have is the parameter value. This is what you're calculating. And this thing on the left-hand side is called the posterior. It gives you the probability distribution of obtaining a value of that parameter, which is important, which is exactly what we wanted. Okay. So this Bayes theorem. Okay. So now I'll be talking about my research, and why I showed you this slide is because it is kind of important to my research. But before I go, do we want to stop for some more questions? Because now it's going to get technical. So yeah.
Yeah. So as this talk is divided into part one and part two, even if we can't cover everything today, each will try to do it tomorrow too.
That sounds good. Yeah.
So I guess we do have a lot of questions, by the way.
Okay.
So they're asking mergers of potential candidates of GRBs. There are studies also for the same source. One can get GRB and gravitational wave. My question is how exactly one can correlate a particular GRP with a particular GW.
Mm-hmm. Again, so Renda, I think this is more to your expertise.
Yeah. So the way they do it is once a gravitational wave signal is actually detected, they pass around something called a, I forgot the name. What is that thing, man, that they share around with all Swift? The astronomers?
The Swift signals? The sky location and everything to look at.
Yeah. That's called something. I forgot suddenly.
Oh, I thought it was called just the Swift signals that Becca was working on.
Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, it's called GCL. Yeah.
Cool. Yeah.
So what they do actually is once they detect these gravitational waves, they make something called a GCN. It's like a circular, which explains what is the sky localization of this gravitational signal and that shape, with all the astronomers all around. So this is a part of initiative called multi-messenger astronomy, and it's based at Penn State, wherein they actually have a network. Okay, so wherein they get a alert for a gravitational signal. Through this network, everyone is sent a notification or LNET that a particular gravitational signal with so-and-so properties has been detected, and the astronomers who have access to these electromagnetic telescopes and observatories, they point out and they search in the particular area of the sky where these gravitational waves might have been detected. So based on some models from theoretical astrophysics, one can actually know after how much amount of time after the gravitational signal can one actually expect a gamma ray burst to happen. And if supposing they actually observe some huge flux in the gamma ray spectrum in the sky localization, in the sky area where the gravitational wave signal was detected, then they try to associate it. And they also try to estimate the distance to this gamma ray burst independent of gravitational waves, and try to see if both can be coming from the same distance, or they try to associate it with a galaxy. Supposing this gamma ray burst is just present in the area where there's a galaxy, and also the gravitational signal has also come from a similar galaxy, then they try to correlate these two. That's all. But on the offline, they do a lot more analysis and a lot more physics is done. But basically, this is it. The signal, the GCN is sent, notification is sent, the distance is measured, and the galaxy, the host galaxy is determined. That's how they try to correlate. Okay. So Naren is asking, can gravitational interfere, like two sources of waves combining to form one? If so, how do we recognize this in our detectors?
Very, very, very good question. So this is a fundamental problem because, of course, this can happen, right? Given the amount of gravitational wave sources you have, it will actually be weird if you never get an interference. But it can happen. And this is actually a problem that, so the person I work with, Professor Satya Prakash at Penn State, he was working with an incoming, he's not an incoming student. He came for like 2 months, Ilya Pizzati. So they were working on this. What they were trying to see is that given LISA, which is going to be our space interferometers, and because we're expecting a lot of detections every day, there will be some that will interfere. So how do you actually differentiate between the two? The thing is, what they found out was that it was actually very difficult to, unless and until the parameters were such that you can exactly see how the two signals are different from each other. But if their parameters are close enough, you can actually not differentiate. It becomes really, really difficult to do that. What do I mean by that? So think about this. Think if you have a neutron star, binary neutron star system, which has length of about 32 seconds. So it lasts for 32 seconds versus if you have a 1509-14 like system that lasts for just 0.1 seconds. Now these two signals can also overlap, but you can easily differentiate the two. However, if you have two new binary neutron star detections coming in, and both of them have similar kind of parameters, which they usually would, like at least the masses, because neutron stars only have so much range, there is not really a good way in which you can differentiate the two signals. So that is a major problem that I don't think people really know the solution to at this point.
Okay. So Nitesh is asking in regards to Naren's question on interference, he's asking, one more question as Naren asked, if it interferes, then like in double slit experiment, the slits act like independent sources. Can mass lying in the path of GW, and can that mass will apparently looks like a source of GW, can be differentiated with the real GW source?
Yes, yes you can. So, okay, correct me if I'm wrong here, but I think what you're getting to is that while the gravitational waves are propagating, if there's a mass lying somewhere in the middle, the gravitational waves sort of propagate through it. Are you sort of going to see the gravitational waves propagating as due to that mass that sort of lied in the path of it or not? Surinder, am I getting the question right, do you think?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, so the answer to that is yes, you will be easily able to differentiate because the gravitational wave itself is not really disturbed all that much when it comes to things lying in its path, because again, remember that it is the ripple on the in the fabric of space-time itself. Okay, so think about it in that way. It is a ripple in the fabric of space-time itself. So it does not get affected to that extent. Again, remember that extent. There are higher order corrections where you actually have these sort of non-linearities, as they put it, which will be there due to the presence of all these, the kind of interference you're talking about, any kind of interference for that matter. But they all are negligible if you have a strong enough signal. And so you won't really see it. But you know, if you have a very, 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 very weak signal, I don't think you can even detect it using using the detectors we have right now. But then you might actually see interference because of such things. No, yeah, but it won't be as strong as what you're mentioning where, you know, a gravitating body itself produces the fact that you actually think that a different gravitating body is producing the signal, even though it was some other thing. So usually it doesn't happen. No.
And Sachin is asking, can GW detectors mistake seismic waves for gravitational waves, or are there very distinct differences between the two for the detectors? How are these accounted for?
Yes, there are very, very big differences between the two. As I said, so there's this thing called the false alarm rate, the FAR that is calculated, which basically, and it is assigned to each and every sort of signal, which essentially says that what is the probability that the signal that we got right now is a false one. Okay, and only when a certain threshold of the false alarm rate is crossed is a signal actually considered seriously. You don't consider all the detections you get. you only consider ones where the false alarm rate is above a certain threshold. So that, like, and these thresholds are not small, by the way. So I remember for one event, the threshold for one event, the false alarm rate was that the probability that this kind of signal will be false is 1 in 10^9 years. And you can imagine what that means. Okay. So that, so only when a signal crosses a certain amount of false alarm rate or a certain threshold of false alarm rate is it considered seriously. So all the signals you're looking at did cross that threshold, and it's all very dependable, so to say. Yeah.
And the next few questions from Vinisha. She's asking, how did we determine the speed of propagation waves?
The speed of gravitational wave being the speed of light just comes from the theory of general theory of relativity itself. And to determine it, I remember there was this thing that you used to do. I mean, there are multiple things you can do, to be honest, where you can, one easy thing to sort of do would be to just see the time difference between getting the signal at, so we have two detectors, right? We have one in Livingston and the other at Hanford. You can just see the time difference between getting the signal between these two detectors and then divided by the distance, and you sort of get it. But is there, I don't remember a reliable test. I mean, there are, obviously, I just don't remember it. Surinder, do you remember one?
Yeah, the one where they use CW17-17, where they actually looked at both the gravitational signal and the electromagnetic counterpart.
Yeah.
And using that, they could actually estimate the distance, and from the distance and from the time, one could actually estimate the speed of the gravitational wave.
Yeah, so that, and also like for every detection, you can sort of do the Livingston and Hanford thing. So you can do it again and again and see that it works. But yeah, go ahead.
And then Vandana is asking, what is the frequency of a gravitational wave and what does it depend upon?
Okay, so it depends on the intrinsic parameters that I talked about, okay, depending on what kind of system it is. And frequency is, again, just think about the wave, right? So let me actually just go back a bit. So we went the other way around. Sorry about this. Let me go back and back and back and one more. I want to go to this figure here. Okay. So you see how some signals are very close to each other while others are more or less spread out, you know, and you can see that the frequency for 1509-14 is higher than the frequency for say 1512-26. This is not a very remarkable event, which is why I don't remember its name. But yeah, and the frequency is essentially how the two bodies are sort of, the two bodies in the compact binary are sort of rotating around each other. So as they come closer and closer, the frequency is sort of increasing, right? Because they'll be rotating faster and faster. For neutron stars, this starts very slowly because they're slowly rotating around each other in the sense that the frequency is not really changing all that much. And as they start coming closer and closer, the frequency of the orbit, or rather the angular velocity and the frequency of the orbit, why not, sort of increases and increases and increases. So that is essentially it.
So Vandana is asking, then should be able to hear the signal.
You should be able to hear a signal. Yeah, it doesn't happen. So you do realize that hearing has to sort of do with the frequency, particularly of how air molecules are vibrating, right? That is very different from just the stretching of space and time. So two different concepts. So if that makes sense. Surinder, do you have a more intuitive answer? I am not sure if that makes complete sense.
Yeah, it's actually a complicated thing. So whenever even we have these discussions, turns out there is a split opinion. Some think that it can be heard and some think that it can't be heard. So I think if we just dig into that, it's a very long discussion. But in short, yeah, we don't really.
No, just one thing though. So about it being heard or not. So you sort of saw how the test particles just get displaced by a very small margin, right? So for a gravitational wave to be that strong that you can actually get the air molecules to collide and sort of vibrate in a very particular way, I think that is very difficult. Don't you think?
Yeah, that's the key argument against why we can't hear. But I think here the question is in principle,
In
rather than.
principle, I see. Okay. Yeah. Okay, I see.
But yeah, I mean, there are a lot of things to consider. But and then, so Siddharth is asking, is the value of a prior a measure of confidence we have in general theory of relativity?
No, not really. So a prior is more or less just you making astrophysical observations about things. Sometimes that. So and other times it is just a basis. So I'll give you an example. Okay. So think about integrating, right? What if you just have, say, a function like integration of x dx, and what if you multiply it with a constant? It doesn't really change the value of integration of x dx, right? All it does is multiplies a constant to the already existing integration. And when you normalize this integration, the constant sort of goes away. You never think about it, right? So that is the case here. If you have good astrophysical sense, okay, where did I go? Yeah. If you have a good astrophysical sense to what a prior can be, or what the distribution of the chirp mass can be for such a system at such a distance or things like that, then you can think of a good educated prior. If you don't have any sort of idea in mind of what kind of a system this can be, just keep a uniform prior, just keep a constant prior, and it automatically gets sort of cancelled out when you normalize things. So it has no effect. So that's more or less the notion behind it. It has nothing to do with your confidence in the theory of general relativity. So yeah.
Okay, and then there's a question from Jnanvi. She's asking, do gravitational waves too tend to follow the shortest path in time, just like light?
Everything will. Yeah, everything will. It's just the law of nature. Everything follows the shortest path, just like light, because your principle of least extreme action, not least action. So yeah.
Ayush is asking, in case of electromagnetic waves, we use standard candles or some other techniques to find the distance of the objects in the universe. For gravitational wave signals, how do we know the distance?
Yeah, again, Surinder, would you want to take this?
Okay.
Essentially, it has to do with the redshift measurement, isn't it? So if you have the redshift measurement, you should be able to calculate the distance from it. Isn't that right?
Yeah, but in the case of black holes, I may not remember.
Doesn't your antenna pattern function have the luminosity distance in it? The distance part in it? Like, if not the antenna pattern function, just like, you know, your waveform H has F cross H cross plus F plus H plus, so antenna pattern into the polarization. And then you have the inclination and the luminosity distance coming inside it anyway. So essentially, it is just you comparing the waveform that you have, which is a function of this luminosity distance,
yeah,
with the gravitational wave data. And that is why, actually, since there is a reason why distance is not very well estimated, and this is the reason, because it doesn't appear in a... So I'll tell you something. Why chirp mass and mass ratio are so important is because they have high correlations between them, meaning that you can measure both of them as a pair very accurately. Okay? What this also means is that when you have a variable like luminosity distance, which does not have like really good correlations with any parameters, it is not so well measured, which is why if you see anything, the like any event, the error bars on the distance are very high compared to the kind of error bars you get for chirp mass or mass ratios. So that, but it is essentially you matching a waveform to the existing data that you have.
Yeah, to add to that, I was about to say that it's also a fitting parameter, luminosity distance. It means you're trying to determine the luminosity distance, as Ish was pointing out. So the only way you can actually have an independent measurement of luminosity distance in the gravitational wave is when you have an electromagnetic component. Next is Nitesh is asking, can we amplify the gravitational waves like in the case of light? We increase it in image intensifiers.
I don't know. So
yeah, I can say just recently. So I Nitesh, we can actually amplify the gravitational signal. We can actually increase its amplitude and also changing its phasing. It happens through gravitation lensing of gravitational waves. Then supposing you have a gravitational wave coming and there is some object in between the path, like a huge galaxy or a supermassive black hole or something, and that can actually act as a lens and lens this gravitational signal. Like you might have heard of gravitational lensing of light, electromagnetic, right? Electromagnetic waves, wherein they try to use this to detect the dark matter content of a galaxy. So similarly, a galaxy can also lens the gravitational signal. And during this process, if one actually looks at the resultant gravitational wave, it might actually have a higher amplitude in higher strain and higher amplitude in gravitational waves. And Saksham is asking, can we use EM waves based measurements at the same position correspond to the same event in the space to know the distance? Yeah, that's what we were trying to do.
For binary neutron stars or for neutron star black hole mergers, because you won't get any EM counterparts for black holes, right?
Yeah. And Ayushi, okay, so if there is GRB associated with it, then we can estimate it. Yeah, that's when we can precisely estimate it.
Yeah.
Okay. So there is one question which has kind of skipped. So it's about, I think. Vinisha is asking, also, is there an analogy between gravitational waves and matter waves from de Broglie's hypothesis?
I don't know. I can't think of an analogy except that both are waves. So yeah, I don't know. I honestly can't think of an analogy except the fact that both are waves. And because see, you can sort of think of it as matter waves also causing some disturbances, but the thing is that the inherent property of that disturbance is different, right? One is a disturbance is in space-time fabric while the other is in just some matter particles. So
I think one is in quantum mechanical nature, so we can't even really compare.
Yeah, that too.
But yeah, by the way, people are asking some really good questions which cannot be answered in the limited time we have, but we can always discuss later too. So Saurav is asking, is there any possibility that the black holes are not true black holes? I would say eternally collapsing objects.
Yeah, sure. I mean, we also have black hole mimickers, right? Where this is a sort of contention that you look at them and you want to see if things happen. And I mean, also not just about like about true black holes as well. There's also this thing that if there are black holes made up of dark matter, so-called dark black holes, you can't actually distinguish them from just normal black holes. So yeah, I mean, there can be objects. Maybe you want to look at black hole mimickers for that, but yeah.
Yeah, just to add to that, I think one of the key ways to test, I think Yish will definitely cover this in his tomorrow's talk. So one of the key aspects is looking at the ring down signal of the gravitational wave. I think that's one best way to differentiate between black holes or something else. But yeah, more on that Yish will talk tomorrow too. So Tanya is asking, is there some instances where general theory of relativity fails, like some phenomenon which cannot be explained by general theory of relativity?
None that I know of, if you're not going to the quantum world. None that I know of, which is why we believe in it wholeheartedly. Nothing that we have done till now, and spoiler alert, not the test that I'm doing either, actually does anything against general relativity. There's nothing. Nothing you have sort of seen that goes against. The only problem with general relativity is sort of that you have the black hole solution which has a singularity. And there, I cannot think of a way to sort of reconcile, but people are trying. So essentially, if you can come up with a theory that reconciles this singularity that you get with a black hole while keeping all the other features that general relativity already has, because it has passed all the tests, then yeah, good enough.
And then Nitesh is asking, what kind of data can we find from primordial gravitational waves?
Oh, primordial gravitational waves. Yeah. So I think that is a talk that is going to happen, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so because I have no idea about primordial gravitational waves, to be honest. Like, what kind of frequencies can you expect? What are you expecting out of them or not? So yeah, I am absolutely not the person you should ask this, but that is a good way to advertise for the talk that's coming up. So yeah.
Yeah, so we do have a speaker, Sumati Gupta, and she'll be talking about early universe and what can we understand about early universe using primordial gravitational waves. So let's keep that question for a future talk. Exactly. So I guess those are all the questions that I saw in the chat.
Brilliant.
So Ish, should we stop here then, or what do you
think? Sounds good. I can sort of, so in tomorrow's talk, what I'm planning to do is I'm actually planning on telling you exactly how data analysis for gravitational waves works. And I'll try to make it possible for you guys to do it by yourself on your current systems, on your current PC and things like that. So we'll see how it sort of goes. And if we have time left, I can, from the same itself, I can sort of motivate my research as well, which we don't have the time to do today anyway. So yeah.
So maybe we'll take one last question. So the space-time fabric, okay. I think it's a very interesting question. Saurav is asking, what is space-time fabric made of? Is it possible that it is made up of dark matter?
Yeah, the answer to that would be that no one knows. But I would think that space-time fabric, for it to have its own gravity, would be a bit weird, because dark matter does have its own gravity. But I have heard this opinion before, so I wouldn't sort of reject it because I haven't thought more about it. But I don't know what space-time fabric can be made of. I don't think anyone does. It is more or less a mathematical realization of what gravity is. So until you come up with a more, physical theory in some sense, where you can give an exact definition to what space-time fabric is, and not just calling it a mathematical quantity like a four-dimensional Hausdorff manifold, until then, I don't think this question can be answered.
And the last question, I think we'll take for this session and then we'll close it. And any other question you may have, you can always email him and also ask in the next session.
For sure.
Math scientist, I think he's from Abitskova. He's asking, GR was published in 1915, the Schwarzschild solution in 1916, but the Kerr solution was not there up till 60s, taking into consideration the rotation of the black hole. Yeah. Can we say that gravitational waves will also motivate a new solution to the field equations?
It would have motivated a new solution to the field equations had it already not been consistent. But everything that we have found till now is absolutely consistent with the field equations that we already have. So I don't know why would it actually motivate. Like, also, what would we try to include? So to that extent, say if we actually, sort of come up with a solution of field equations that also include charge, and we find that signature in a gravitational wave, then sure, that can be one thing. But other than that, I am not too sure.
Yeah. Okay. And thank you, Ish. Thank you very much for your time. I know how busy you are.
Thanks a lot, Surendra. Thank you for helping me answer the questions as well. And yeah, sounds good to me.
Yeah, okay. Maybe last question you can take up. It's related to your interest. Solution for black hole information paradox. Is there any hint? Saurav is asking.
Black hole information paradox through gravitational waves? No way. You have to realize that things related to Hawking radiation, the reason why Hawking never got a Nobel is because Hawking radiation was never discovered. And that is because it's very, very weak. And when we're talking about gravitational waves are, sort of how much massive an object has to be to produce gravitational waves. So I don't really think you can get anything out of the information for the information paradox. I do have, the bad thing about LIGO is that you cannot say certain things to people who are not LIGO members. But I can say that there was a presentation, I think about 6 months ago, by a person, I don't know which university, who sort of was talking about something like this, about calculating a quantity that will give us hints about black hole information using gravitational wave data. I was not too convinced, neither was anyone in that meeting, so I won't be too sure about it.